In 1959, Berry Gordy gathered the best musicians from Detroit's thriving jazz and blues scene to cut songs for his new record company. Over a 14-year period, they were the heartbeat on My Girl, Bernadette, I Was Made to Love Her, and every other hit from Motown's Detroit era. By the end of their phenomenal run, this unheralded group of musicians had played on more number one hits than the Beach Boys, the Rolling Stones, Elvis, and the Beatles combined, which makes them the greatest hit machine in the history of pop music. They called themselves the Funk Brothers.
It was bigger than we thought it was gonna be. We didn't know it was gonna be that big. To be or not to be, it was being. First, we didn't notice what was going on. We were too busy creating the music and the magic. Finally, you know that you have played them, hit records, and the jukeboxes and the radios playing, and somebody say, oh boy, that's Motown, but they never know us. Nobody never mentioned too much about us, you know. Really, a long time it goes, and finally it gets to you. Finally, when the dust cleared, it was all over, and we realized we were being left out of the dream. It's the end. And as the years go by, we wonder, will anyone ever know who we are or what we did?
They were the days of American innocence. A father knows best. Lady Day passed on, and Fats Domino enticed the nation to visit Blueberry Hill. Elvis Presley burst out of Mississippi like a tornado, gathering followers from every sphere of American life. There was a cultural tidal wave in his hips and music. Radio stations flooded the country with this new sound from the South. But the roots of that music, the originators, remained unknown. These pioneers of rhythm and blues could be found at the far reaches of the radio dial, playing soulfully for their loyal fans. But they were confined to frustration as they watched their white counterparts triumph with the style they'd created. Struggling to find the key to mainstream America's heartbeat, scores of black artists and record companies searched for a new sound that would free them from the race music label. In Detroit, that sound arrived.
Now if you feel that you can't Yeah, we're doing a documentary about some music. You know a lot about music? You gotta know something about music.
I know something about music.
You know anything about Motown?
I like to listen to Motown.
Yeah, I was brought up on that stuff.
You know about Motown?
Oh, yes.
You know a lot about music?
I like to think so.
Yes, I'm from Detroit.
Yeah.
Motown, yeah, sure. The sound of Detroit.
I know a little too much about music.
What's your favorite Motown group?
Well, I wouldn't say group, but I'd go with Marvin Gaye.
I'd have to say it's Smokey Robinson, probably.
Well, of course, Stevie Wonder. I love the Supremes.
Four times.
Would you happen to know who played the music on the Supremes albums? You know, the instruments and stuff.
I have no idea.
Did you ever think about that?
I think about it with others. No, I haven't, actually.
You know who played the music for Smokey?
Not a real fan.
It's the Miracles.
Well, it was Gladys Knight and the Pips, wasn't it? But did they play the music?
The Pips.
I don't think I know any of the musicians.
Yeah, I'm familiar with Marvin Gaye. His band? No, unfortunately, I can't say.
What if I told you it was a group called the Funk Brothers? Played on all that stuff.
Wow, I had no idea.
Who are the Funk Brothers? Who are they?
Really?
If it's true, I would believe it.
They still around?
People will ask, what is the Motown sound? They've asked producers, they've asked executives from Motown. What was the Motown sound? It was the musicians, okay?
When these cats cut tracks, it really, no offense to any of the great artists that sang on them, but anybody could have sang on it. You could have Deputy Dog singing on some of this stuff and been a hit because the tracks were just so incredible.
The way they
laid them. They were musical entities unto themselves.
They had a natural feel for music, you know? They were just that exceptional.
Being really good jazz musicians, they could swing like crazy. And that's something that's not always present in pop music.
The bass drum had a note. It wasn't a dead, it was the boom. So you had boom, cha-boom, 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 boom, boom.
When there's a groove like that, the subliminal effect is everybody feels good.
They were the groundwork. They were the things that everything else was built on.
It was like a river, constantly flowing. Talent, creations, you know, people come in, you know, who's available? Who's on the list? We'll call them in. Where are they? Are they out of town? This one's out of town. We'll call the other one. But it was always the Funk Brothers. Always the Funk Brothers first.
Without them, there really wouldn't be a Motown. That was the sound, that was the foundation. That was it. That was the essence of Motown.
That essence was an overpowering lineup of veteran groove masters and trailblazing virtuosos, guitarists Eddie Willis, Joe Messina, and Robert White, and keyboardists Johnny Griffith, Joe Hunter, and Earl Van Dyke wove an irresistible tapestry of instrumental hooks and counter-rhythms over the electrifying core of the Motown groove. A core comprised of James Jamerson, the tormented genius of the Motown bass, and late-era bassist Bob Babbitt, percussionist Jack Ashford and Eddie Bongo Brown, drummers Uriel Jones, Pistol Allen, and the explosive Benny Papa Zeta Benjamin, the creator of the Motown drum beat. The dance floors of the world didn't stand a chance. After World War II, the auto industry boom turned Detroit into an economic magnet for people in search of steady work. Tens of thousands migrated to the city, among them several future funk brothers.
Actually, Jameson came from South Carolina. Eddie Willis came from Mississippi. Pistol came from Memphis, Tennessee, and I'm from Jackson, Tennessee. We came north, mostly our people came north, to get jobs in the car factories here in Detroit, Michigan. And I worked at Chevrolet myself. I worked at Chevrolet for about a year and a half. And the last thing we wanted to do was work in the factories. We really wanted to play music, and that's what we end up doing. The Funk Brothers end up playing music. Barry showed up down to Little Sam's one time, and he walked over by the bandstand while we were playing, and he said to me, would you have time to talk to me? I says, I got more time than money. And he explained to me what he was about. He wanted to set up a record company, and he needed good musicians. I thought it was a wonderful idea, and I wanted to know that I know anybody that could feel the thing. He already knew Mr. Benjamin, Benny Benjamin, Papacito. So actually, he called the first rehearsal over to Claudette's house, Smokey Robinson's wife at that time. That was late 58, and then Papacito was already there, and I was there. We eventually found the great James Jameson on bass.
I remember my dad saying as a child growing up that he would take a stick and take a rubber band and put one part of the rubber band at one end, the other part at the other, and stick it in an ant hole and make the ants dance.
When he was a kid on Edisto Island, James and his friends would slip through a window into their little two-room schoolhouse. They'd light a fire and play the piano until class started. After school, they'd continue making music in a neighbor's vacant summer home, where there just happened to be an old piano and an upright bass.
Well, the most important pointer that my father taught me, when I'm playing, if I don't feel it, don't play it. And, you know, a lot of guys would just play straight. And with no feeling, but he would play like. You know, put something in it. He just felt life, you know, that life was music. And he used to tell this story like this one song he did. He saw a fat woman walking down the street. And just her butt going from boom to boom to boom, ba-dum, ba-dum. That was his interpretation of music. So he put music to just about anything that had life to it. There's an indentment right here in the bass where he kept his thumb right here as a rest. That's how old this bass is. So you can see all the dirt on here. As he says, the dirt keeps the funk. This has been the original bass ever since he started playing. Before he switched over to precision. He used this on Heatwave, My Guys, Shop Around, most of the Mary Wells stuff, You Beat Me to the Punch, some other earlier stuff with Stevie. Yeah, he played with one finger on all those hits, just like this finger was called the hook. And it would hook like this. All the songs that you heard basically was done with one finger. I have trouble playing with two fingers the line that he played, so.
You couldn't even touch his timing. Because he could hear another time in his head and be playing cut time against what you're playing. That's and correct. It would fit.
There was never a bass player on no coast then. If that was a West Coast, East Coast, whatever coast you want to call it, that was comparable to a James Jameson.
It's the height of creativity, you know, and freedom and experimentation and fearlessness. You have to be absolutely fearless to play those notes in that place and yet be responsible for for the bottom of the groove like that.
I thought bass playing was played like that all the time, but little did I know that it was my father changing the course of bass.
soon about 1960, Barry bought a house on West Grand Boulevard. This house had a garage with a dirt floor.
Walk down the four time-worn wooden steps into the basement of 2648 West Grand Boulevard, and you enter a fantasy land. A tiny, dimly lit room with smoke-stained walls where dreams came true for Motown's young stars. A place where timeless classics like I Can't Help Myself, Shop Around, and Where Did Our Love Go were born. This is Hitsville, USA, the home of the Motown sound. But to the musicians who work there, it was just Studio A, affectionately referred to as the Snake Pit. It was the site of countless steamy 4 a.m. sessions where monster hits were cranked out in an hour or less. A place where deadly grooves threatened to set the walls on fire. This was the home of Motown's studio band, the Funk Brothers.
Boogie was the main one that would pull this off. He'd dream of a song. He'd come in the studio with something written down, maybe two bars or two verses of it on some paper. It's basically, hey man, I got a tune, and what do you think of this? And he'd play it, and next thing you know, Joe would say, well, this is what you're trying to play. And he'd give him the chord and full structure. The next thing you know, hey, come here, James. And he'd make James play this line, and in a minute, you'd have a song. That's how the studio was every day. And they'd fight to get a studio in.
This is the first time we've been in here to play since the 70s. A lot of these people come here for the first time. They have no idea what's in here. Mm-hmm. Because along with our creativity was Barry's prayers in here that we would be successful in what we were doing to make those hits. And then we used to hear it in his voice. We used to hear the way he used to talk to us. We used to hear the artists, how they would talk to us. A lot of prayers were in this building, wasn't it, Joe?
Yeah, true. I mean,
you have no idea the gravity of what went on emotionally. I swear to God, when I went in there tonight, I could just feel it. I could almost touch it. It never left that room.
Yeah, it's a strange feeling.
It never left that room. Yeah. It's in there.
Thinking of you, oh, you treat me bad. was playing up in Boston, Massachusetts, when I ran into Marvin Gaye. I didn't know who he was, and someone from his entourage said, I want you to meet a famous singer. I said, okay. And he said, his name is Marvin Gaye. So I didn't realize Marvin was standing there with the guy. I didn't know who he was. So he said, you ever heard of Marvin Gaye? I said, nah, never heard of him. If you don't play jazz, I don't know him. I was kind of cocky because all jazz musicians were cocky. Everybody wanted to be like Miles Davis, no matter what instrument you played. So I talked with Marvin, and he was telling me about he was starting a band and would I like to come to Detroit. So no musician turns down a good gig. So I said I'd come.
Was this like a garage area or?
Garage. Yeah, it was a dirt floor from the beginning. They had a piece of plywood in this area with the piano sitting right there.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. Okay. And the walls had carpeting. It's a cinder block. And the entrance was right about there.
You know, not being a bass player, not being a guitar player, not being a drummer, the arrangers would come in and just have a general idea of or concept, and we leave it up to the masters.
You allow 4 songs in a 3-hour session,
right?
And we would get no less than 2. But that's because the same guys played together all the time. So I mean, the only thing that changed was the changes. And it was like a home down there. We spent so much time there.
It was always usually Jameson kicking something off and everybody falling in, either Benny. If Benny kicked something off, Jameson had something to throw in that fitted. And then everybody could come in.
Back then, you guys would have to do the tune all in one take.
Yes.
Beginning to end, yes.
In the earlier days, they only had 3 tracks to work with.
I think it was a great school for mixing because you had to learn how to mix because you only had one shot at it.
That's right. You had to get it right the first time.
That's right.
We felt as though it was our job to really lay the groundwork for these kids to have as a place to really develop their careers in singing because we had the experience. They had the talent, we had the experience.
They were all really young, right?
Oh, they were very young. Most of the producers were young. In fact, all of the producers were young.
There was a bunch of fellows standing around drinking a little wine called the Contours. And we was up there doing a funny band track, something I'd never heard before, you know, and had the charts out. We start playing, you know, start playing the chart when the director came up there. And after we finished, I said, that will never be a hit. And the Contours walked up to each one of us like a little kid eating ice cream. Ooh, thank you. That's a beautiful band track. And I said, they're crazy.
You know, you broke my heart, 'cause I couldn't dance. You didn't even want me around. But now I'm back to let you know that I can really shake them down. Oh, do you love me?
I can really move.
Do you love me?
I'm in the groove.
Do you love me?
Do you love me now that I can dance?
Watch it now. A little bit of soul now.
days of Motown, the Funk Brothers played on some big hits like The Miracles' Shop Around, The Marvelettes' Please Mr. Postman, and Mary Wells' You Beat Me to the Punch. But still, there was not enough recording work down in the Snake Pit to make a living. So in 1961, James Jamerson, Joe Hunter, and a few of the other band members left to go on the road with Jackie Wilson. But Wilson was recovering from a gunshot wound and didn't have the strength to perform more than once or twice a week. Realizing their new situation was worse, they returned home to Motown, where Berry Gordy welcomed them back with open arms. But their touring days were not yet over.
Like in the early 60s, you went out with the Marvelettes.
Right.
I went out with Marvin, you know, and Stevie Wonder.
Yeah.
And then we did gigs maybe, you know, 200 miles outside Detroit occasionally.
That wasn't nothing.
Yeah, Joe.
The first really big tour was the 1962 Motown Revue.
Right.
Where we had 31 nighters in New England and in the South, and then 10 days at the Apollo.
Oh, man.
And
that's a long
that
trip.
Was a thriller. Yeah. All that was a thriller.
Yeah.
We were on the road, you know, and coming back from up north on that gig.
Yep.
And everyone was packed in the car, half sleeping and everything.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, as I think back on that, Marvin Gaye was the drummer on that gig, wasn't he?
Yeah. That was ridiculous.
I think he was a better singer, though.
You know, that's right. And they had us in this big old station wagon.
Right, right.
It was about 2 o'clock in the morning.
Right.
And it was freezing.
And Jameson in the car with
Ain't
you.
That something?
Man, you know, that was rough.
Yeah.
About 10 degrees outside, we were coming down the mountainside. We were all dozing off. We told all the jokes we could think of. When Jameson says, "Can you pull the car over?" "Robert, can you pull the car over?"
"You pull. What are you doing, man? Hurry up, man. It's cold outside."
So he pulls over to the side of the road, goes back there, he gets in the trunk, pulls his brown paper bag out. Jumps back in the car.
Come on,
he decides to put his pajamas on in the back of the car.
For me to go to sleep, I got to put my PJs on.
He's bumping people all on the sides and slamming people's heads and everything. And everybody's complaining now. Everybody settles back down again, because we knew by being around James, you try to keep him as tranquil as possible because he can really get out there. And all of a sudden, that bag rustles again. Smelled like somebody kicked a doggone skunk in the behind.
Hell no.
Everybody really got ticked about that because it was rancid. So, man, we raised so much cane in that end, you know, he just said, okay.
All right, I might put the top back on.
No.
I might.
Back
on. Come on, man.
That stuff stinks, man.
Just because, you know, just to keep the peace.
So he put the lid back on it. So he's sitting back. Everybody's kind of dozing again. And we see a light in the back. Somebody lit a match. It's Jameson. He lights his funky, stony cigar.
That's it.
Hey, Rob.
Rob, pull the car over, man.
We say, "Hey, man, pull the car. We're putting him out."
Somebody needs to regulate you, James, man. That ain't right.
So sure enough, Robert pulls over to the side. Out goes James with his funky pig feet, his pajamas, and his cigar.
That's right. That was Jameson for you.
We thought about it and went back.
Yeah, to run over his butt.
Benny played with DFC, Charlie Parker, Ray Charles, Lloyd Folsom, and Muddy Waters, Jimmy Reed, Chuck Berry. Benny played with him. Best was out there.
He was the main standard drummer, and I was the pianist at that time.
Right.
And before Earl got there. Anyway, we liked to frequent the coin liquor places. He had a taste for coin liquor. So this day we went, and we hadn't had too much sleep. And Benny was up there. They was doing a tune called Hitchhike by Marvin Gaye. They kicked off the tune, and Benny was nodding and dropped his sticks. So the A&R man went up there and smelled his breath. He said, Benny. I said, you've been drinking, Benny. He picked up his sticks real quick and he said, Papa Cedar, Papa Cedar, Papa Cedar. So after that, everybody in the studio start calling him Papa Cedar.
He come in the studio one time late and he told Barry, say, man, I was on my own freeway, on my way here. Say the traffic got tied up because the circus had just come into town and the truck had an accident and the elephants got out the truck and got loose and was holding up the traffic.
Oh, man.
And, everybody knew. They knew he was lying because, look, guess what? Benny didn't even try.
First of all, Benny was a master at locking a tempo. He was like a, metronome. He would lock it, see. And then he had certain kinds of pickups which were only unique to him.
For instance, Benny Benjamin pickup would go like this. Like that, you know? That's different. Okay, Earl Jones would play, you know. Then if I would play it four bars or something like that, I'd play.
All three of those pickups came from Papa C, Benny Benjamin. You know, he originated them.
I'm really curious as to how y'all got the name the Funk Brothers.
And look here, one day when Benny got ready to leave, he walked up them steps and Benny said, you all are the Funk Brothers. And I remember that all of my days. Yeah. All of my days. And we are the Funk Brothers.
Thank you.
I was raised in Detroit. I studied classics for about 10, 12 years. Then I found out I couldn't make any money doing that. So I went on a rampage of singers. I worked for so many, I was a companies. So I did some work with Sarah Vaughan. I did some work with Lou Rawls and Dinah Washington. She was the queen of the blues, supposedly at that time, you know, until Aretha, and they crowned Aretha the new queen of the blues. I was working with her at that time. So I worked with both the queens. I was working in a club, and first Mickey Stevens came by, and then he told me, how would I like to be a studio musician? I said, well, what is that? He said, well, come by the studio and listen to what Joe is doing and work from that point. I said, okay, fine. So I went by there, and Joe was doing this record with Pride and Joy or something like that. So I said, listen, I said, what the hell are you doing? You know, because it didn't seem, we never played to nobody singing. And the tracks, you just cut the tracks and you just play. I said, well, how do you know what to play? Because I was used to accompanying. So he said, well, just play what you want to play. He said, they don't know what they're listening to anyway. He said, just play. He said, if it's too much, they'll let you know. He was my introduction to the you know, R&B record scene. Joe is the man around town as far as recording. He's been recording for everybody.
Actually, my mother, she could teach up to around about the third grade of music, so she had a lot of little students in the area. Because I was out trying to shoot marbles and play football with the rest. They didn't figure I had any talent. But I'd be listening to everything that she was practically teaching when I was in the living room. Actually, I thought it was a spiritual thing, really. The way that it came about, I was trying to play Stormy Weather, and it looked like the keys were just going by themselves, and I was trying to stick my hands into those holes and catch up with the keys. When my grandmother came in, she said, Donna, that's what she called my mother, she said, this boy is in here playing Stormy Weather. My favorite classical pianist was Rachmaninoff. I heard him. He had such a terrific left hand. And I said, I wish my left hand could be like that, you know. So I'd put my right hand in my pocket and just play with my left, trying to get as fast as Art Tatum and Rachmaninoff.
In the 1960s, jazz clubs were springing up all over Detroit with names like the Flame Show Bar, Phelps Lounge, the Apex, the 20 Grand, and the Chit Chat. These venues were oases where the Funk Brothers could escape the pressure cooker atmosphere of the studio by returning to their roots and playing cool jazz into the wee hours of the morning. New ideas that hatched in these spirited jam sessions often shimmied their way into the snake pit, adding new textures and rhythms to the Motown sound.
Stage name, Lottie the Body, and I had a beautiful body, and I was exotic dancer, one of the greatest exotic dancers in the world. As a matter of fact, I consider being the greatest. And I work with small bands, big orchestras. Chetty Harris, big orchestra. I work with Count Basie.
You had to know how, if she moved one cheek, there's a certain drum she wants you to hit. If she moved the left leg, there's a certain drum you want to hit. And you had to catch all this stuff, plus keeping rhythm with the band. You know, but after you work with her a while, you fill her out, and it was a little easy. But the first time I worked with her, I swore I wasn't going to do it again.
I'm sorry, darling.
But I came out, oh, it was a pleasure to be here, too.
Sure. You feel like it?
Yeah, let's do it, baby.
Don't kill me, baby.
I don't kill you.
It's
going
to make me feel good.
A lot of rhythms that we did do in the studio is rhythms that came from working with Lottie, because we weren't doing too much what you call Afro-Cuban. You know what I'm talking about? So when we, you know, just like both great vibes, Marvin Gaye's like doom, 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 and the Glass, doom, 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 all that Latin stuff. Well, we did all that stuff with Lottie. This is the spot where a whole lot of stuff happened. This third, one, two, three, the third door over there, that's where the chit-chat was. And I was coming here today early. When I passed by here, I looked over there and said, oh, there they are. It couldn't be no clearer.
The Chit Chat was a place, though it was small, everybody in Detroit knew about the Chit Chat and knew what was happening at the Chit Chat. With Motown being not that far down the street here, you had any Motown act would show up at the Chit Chat, from Marvin to Four Tops, Contours, the Originals, the Temps.
We were still at really enjoying our jazz thing then, you know.
But we did things here that we would do in the session the next day.
Right, sure.
You know, I mean, we would do things like, for instance, that was the uniqueness of the Funk Brothers, because if we were doing a tune and a change was similar to something in one of the jazz tunes that we played, Earl would say, well, do so-and-so, so-and-so, yeah, like we did last night. And we would interject that into the change of the song.
That's right.
And the song would take on a different color, something that they hadn't planned on, but of course the producers, oh man, that's hit. Yeah. And they had a hit.
The Funk Brothers ruled the nightlife of Detroit's club scene in the 60s. But their realm was a rough and tumble world, where getting paid at the end of the evening often proved as challenging as the music they were playing.
Benny was working with us, and Benny used to go in there in the daytime when we wasn't working and drink. And sometime I think the waitress would sort of put a higher tab on him than anything else. But when the owner got ready to pay us off, he'd reach up in his thing and pull out a great big old fat gun, looked like a German Lucas 45, and popped it on the table. Then he looked around at each one of us and said, well, you know your drummer, Benny, has over-tabbed. He says, in fact, he's gone into y'all's money. So at that particular time, Jameson pulled out a piece, his piece, and laid it down. He says, I've got to feed my family. He looked. And Robert White pulled out a piece, and nobody expected Robert to pull out a piece, and he laid his down. And he looked around, and I pulled out my little 22 and laid it down. He said, what kind of band have I got here? He got so confused until he even paid Benny. He paid everybody.
Motown was really, it was America's introduction to soul music. It was America's introduction to soul music. And soul music is powerful. Soul music makes you believe. Soul music gives you hope in the way that you feel, in the way that you want to feel, you know. And that's what was coming out of the sounds I heard these men making as a child. It gave me unconscious hope. I didn't know why. You know, it gave my father hope. So for years and years, players and producers have been trying to find that magic Motown sound and pocket, as if it's some sort of a formula.
People would always say everything but the musicians. They would say it was the artists, the producers, the way the building was structured, or the wood in the floor, or maybe even food, you know. But I like to see them take some barbecue ribs or hamburgers or anything and throw down in that studio, shut the door and count off 1, 2, 3, 4 and get a hit out of there. The formula was the musicians.
I'll be Earl Van Dyke. Let me give you an example. We're going to take Ain't Too Proud to Be, which I think everybody's familiar with. All right, Euro, give it to me. You and Pistol.
If I deep in my heart. And each day it grows more and more. I'm not ashamed to call and plead to you, baby. And pleading keeps you from walking out my door. Ain't too bad to pay. Sweet darling, please don't let me hurt. Ain't too proud to be.
By the time the Funk Brothers recorded Jimmy Ruffin's What Becomes of the Brokenhearted in 1966, the Motown sound had traveled a great distance from the Twist records and blues and doo-wop influenced tracks of its early days. Advances in recording technology and an influx of skilled arrangers and composers had brought about new levels of sonic clarity and musical sophistication. But the most noticeable difference was power. Raw power. The added muscle coincided with the emergence of keyboardist Earl Van Dyke as one of the central figures down in Studio A. He was a natural-born leader whose forceful playing style was jokingly called guerrilla piano. Van Dyke became the hub through which Motown's producers and arrangers often communicated their ideas to the band.
He was like the glue for everything, Earl was. You know, he's a solid keyboard. You know, he'd have the piano rocking, actually rocking. That's why they call him Big Funk, okay? They'd have to have a piano tuner come in and really redo things after Earl got through playing, see, because he put so much muscle into it.
When Earl came in, that's when we developed the style of two pianos playing, not together, but accompanying each other.
But there were so many good days among the musicians in the studio, you know.
You guys had fun.
We had fun. We had fun, you know. And you must, like I said before, there was kids like Stevie, who we could never get rid of. Stevie liked to hang out with the guys, you know, by him being a musician. So we could never really get rid of Stevie. And Stevie's always been Stevie and the Four Tops, Marvin Gaye. They've always been Bobby Taylor. The older guys have always been our favorites. You know?
How sweet it is to love.
He was part of the foundation of Motown. He was one of the first ones to teach me piano. A lot of the people here today are really people that were the musical foundation of Motown. Earl was a great man, and most of all, a spiritual man.
Stevie came here with Mr. Paul, Clarence Paul. They were standing on the steps as you go into the studio. When we got through doing the little ditty, the first thing he walked over to was the piano where I was. He says, "Oh, I like the way you play the piano." Bam, I showed him a few chords, and he said, "What's that?" I said, "Well, that's an E-flat major, and I'm throwing a color tone in there, which is the flatted fifth and so forth and so on." He said, "Yeah," he shook his head, "yeah, you know." And so finally, I found out about a year later, he didn't need me. He didn't learn more than I'd learned. And the same thing with Benny. Benny taught him how to hold his wrists and how to use those sticks, and I don't think he needed Benny. You know,
I don't know. Worked with him.
Yeah. When I started playing music, I didn't start on drums. I was playing trombone. And at the same time I was playing trombone, I was training down at Brewster Center, you know, boxing. And I was determined to do both of them. But it was kind of hard because they was kicking my butt at Brewster. And when I come to class to play trombone, my lip be all sort of, I be trying to play out the side of my mouth, you know. So my music teacher told me, say, "Man, you got to make up your mind. You're going to either box or you're going to be a musician, you know." So I say, okay, so that's when I started playing drums. And so I didn't have a full set of drums. I had a snare drum. I had a hi-hat. I don't know what I was using for a semi. I don't remember. But I know my bass drum was one of those old, heavy cardboard beer cases. And I read to the day, I have never found a sound that sounded as good as that beer case did.
We were sneaking around town, different studios, United Sound.
Pack three.
You know, and we was doing a little outside moonlighting.
Because you weren't supposed to, with you had
no,
like a...
See, because these guys, some of these guys were under contract, you know, exclusive contracts, you know. So, you know, Motown, they wanted to keep the sound.
Yeah,
which, you know, I guess they was paying for it, I guess, for a few few bucks. You know. So they started putting spies around, man, at different places, you know, like in hidden cars and behind buildings and the shrubbery that was near the studio. You know, they had spies like that, you know, around, you know.
They offered me $100 a week to be a spy.
How much?
$100.
$100 a week.
$100.
Extra
$100 a week. So naturally, I took it. I said, well, yeah, you know, because throw it all in the pot. It's all the same money. So I had no intentions of spying on anybody anyway.
When they see us coming out, it'd be at least a couple of them are going to say, you know, oh, we caught you. You fired. And this is real. And he said to Jack, you're fired twice. Because we saw you coming out of there yesterday.
Finally, they called me and said, look, we're paying you. You haven't told us anything. Who's doing what? Where? I said, well, nothing happening. They said, well, no. I said, we got pictures of people coming out of the studios. So as a result, you're fired. So I said, wait a minute. I said, now, how can you fire me? I said, now, from what I've seen, James Bond and all these guys, I said, you spy, you get a Maserati or you get a, you know. I said, you gonna give me $100 a week? I can't even buy gas, you know. So they said, well, look, we're still firing you. So I lost my job as a spy, but they let me continue to play piano.
Even during Motown's golden period, when Hitsville sessions were going on around the clock, the Funk Brothers were still dashing all over Detroit, recording for any studio or record label that offered them another opportunity to create some magic. Among the hits recorded outside of Motown were Jackie Wilson's Higher and Higher, John Lee Hooker's Boom Boom Boom, and the Capitals' hit dance tune, Cool Jerk. '60s, Motown was a permanent fixture at the top of the Billboard charts. As their artists chalked up one number one hit after another, they began to emerge as some of the brightest stars in the galaxy of R&B and pop music. But the Funk Brothers remained earthbound and unknown. While they were beginning to share some of the financial success, they missed out on that elusive entity, glory. Their last great tour before they became totally studio-bound opened their eyes to what fame could mean. It was the acclaimed 1965 Tamla Motown Review that took England by storm.
What amazed me, they actually knew the musicians. When we got off of the plane in London, these little British guys come running up to us with these signs. You know, I said, who are these guys? They walked up and said, we're the James Jamerson Appreciation Fan Club. Yeah. I said, James Jameson? He's not even with us. I said, shit, well, maybe I'll be James Jameson. I can use the fan club.
I knew that's right.
While Motown invaded the UK, the British were invading the US armed with some American weapons, Motown tunes. The Beatles landed in New York with cover versions of Please Mr. Postman, Money, and You've Really Got a Hold on Me in their musical arsenal. John Lennon remarked that the Motown drummer hit his snare with so much force, it sounded like he hit it with a bloody tree. There was no doubt they were listening to Motown's musicians and listening hard. In subsequent years, other British bands covered Motown hits, including the Rolling Stones, with their renditions of Ain't Too Proud to Beg, My Girl, and Going to a Go-Go. The Funk Brothers' musical influence had spread to musicians all over the world, whether they knew it or not.
You know, in the mid-60s, when we were at Motown, we were pretty hot, and we would have producers lined up back-to-back waiting to get into the studio to work with us. They didn't even consider the fact that it was a 12-hour, 14-hour day sometimes. Rick Baines, when you play the song so much until it begins to get stiff, and everybody's tired, and you say, rigor mortis is here now. Because you exhausted your creativity on it, you know. Which happens sometimes, because especially when we had a producer that we told him he was wasting his money, then he's going to prove to us that he wasn't.
Yeah.
Take 64. He's not flogging us and everything. So, wasn't nothing really going to happen then. So we had to find some place to relax, because it was really a pressure cooker in the snake pit at that time. One time, Earl came up and said that he'd found a funeral parlor that we could go and hide out.
Shit.
So we would just do this on, you know, on many occasions, because, as I said, we were cutting 7 days a week. The studio finally found out where we were hanging out. And damn, Motown didn't send somebody over there from management to knock on the door to find out where we were hiding.
What's that smell?
Just a little embalming fluid.
Earl had had the funeral director trained what to say in the event that someone would come over there.
But I really, really have to go. Well, wait. I want to show you how to use my saw and bone crusher.
We're going to fall out laughing. You're not going to believe this. I was forced to play a tambourine.
In church?
No, no.
No, what?
With Charles Harris. Came to the rehearsal when they were a big tambourine. Looked like a dishpan.
Right.
I'd never touched one. So I got finished doing my solo. He said, pick the tambourine up, man. I said, hell no. He said, pick the tambourine. He got angry because I wouldn't pick the tambourine up. So I picked the damn tambourine up. I didn't know what happened. And I said, damn, this feels good. And I started playing, and the tambourine just took on a life of its own.
I came from Memphis, Tennessee, and I started, first beginning of drums and everything, I started in a commerce class, you know, on a Royal typewriter, you know. I wanted to be a CPA and an engineer, so we had to take typing class, you know. So I was sitting there at the desk and listening to drum beats, so I wind up playing drum beats on the typewriter. So the teacher said, hey, what do you want to do, play the drums or be a CPA? I said, I think I want to play the drums, so she kicked me out, and that's how I really got into playing drums, you know. And I moved to Detroit, West End, with Kenny Burrell, Pep Adams, all the guys, got into jazz thing. And then while at the 20 grand, with Levi Mann, Benny used to come in and play some of the shows, you know. I met Benny Benjamin, you know. And Benny said, hey, man, you sound good. Why don't you come down? He said, look, you can come, you can play this stuff. It's easy. All you got to do is play that, and keep your mouth closed. Fine, I got in.
Great, man. The beat on the tom-tom like that, it came like the old Indian wall dance. It took and put a backbeat to it. You're like, boom, 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 boom. Put a backbeat to it. So Shank and Joe Mazzini's three guitars. And so Jameson came in. So Shank, Joe, and Robert came an octave ahead of, you know, Jameson. And that's where that funk got to get in. But you got to have that head action in it. So you like that.
Ooh, I bet you wondered how I knew.
Oh, man. Look at you get it out already.
Turn the tape on.
Thank you.
between the two of us, guys, you know I love you more. It took me by surprise.
Success of We Heard It Through the Grapevine. At the same time, it was a mixed emotion type thing going on.
Benny Benjamin, he had a drug problem, bad drug problem, and was just about at the bottom. But at one point, Benny kind of disappeared for a couple of weeks. So Earl, you know, started trying to find out what happened to him. And he found Benny. And Earl came in just before the session started and just said, guys, I don't think there's going to be no session. Say, Benny just died. And,
that was... It turned everybody around.
Yeah, right? It turned... Just we didn't do no session that day.
Yeah.
You know, when they would pass the music out to the musicians, every group would get their little stuff together. I'd get together with Earl because I played vibes, and they'd pass the music over to the guitar players, and they would huddle together over there, you know, like a group of little magpies working on it. They'd be trying their little parts and laughing up their sleeve. We got them. And so Earl would just look at them, you know, and they'd name them Heckle, Jekyll, and Son, and they'd jump up and say, yeah, we got it, we're ready. And so, you know, and it really tear it up, too, because they really did have it together.
All of it was important, as you know, the parts. And we just work around each other, and nothing ever ran into each other, you know.
I think the magic was we'd listen to each other, and we liked each other, yeah, which was important.
Yeah, right, Joe. Yeah.
We had a friendship. I think that helped.
I was born in Mississippi. My little town was Grenada, Mississippi. I built my own guitar. Broom wire and attached it to the house, and I made the house rock. And I moved to Detroit in 1952.
My dad had a guitar in the house. He liked the instrument. He used to play Italian weddings when they played the Italian music.
All that influenced me, you know. I mean, just anybody, whoever was playing guitar, and listening to radio and listening to Chet Atkins, B.B. King, Albert King.
I'd practice all day. At times I would skip school to practice.
First gig was with this group, with Marv Johnson, and eventually he did take me into Motown, and I did a couple of his recordings. So what happened, everybody liked what they heard, you know. I was playing some pretty good funk, man, you know, and they kind of went for it, so I ended up staying there.
I end up on the night show with Soupy Sales. I was there for 14 years. We had some very good musicians, yeah.
Who used to come there?
We had Charlie Parker. Miles, Coltrane. I never listened to guitar players, mainly the horn men, more in the jazz vein. I'd like Charlie Parker, so I'd get all his records. I was working a club called the 20 Grand with Levi Mann, and Barry came in, and he talked to me, asked me if I wanted to record for him. I said, yes, I will.
Did y'all mention Eddie Bongo? Because he was a funk brother.
All through.
Okay. Eddie was a good guy. Eddie kept a whole lot of mess going. And he was Marvin's right-hand man.
The thing I remember about him most was his conga playing. He could really play.
If there was one guy that kept things loose, it was Eddie Bongo Brown.
Bongo got the music sheet sitting up. I don't know why the hell he put that music sheet up there. He couldn't even read. Had the sheet sitting up there, got the producer trick. Bongo's just playing his ass off. He's playing boom, 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 boom. And I look over there, and he's got a nudie magazine sitting up there with legs gapped open with moon feet. I said, oh, my God. And they swore that he was reading.
He invented a couple licks that I hear a lot now. I think he borrowed them from the Caribbean, where he'd lick his finger and slide it over the drum and get a great sound. He got all kinds of neat little sounds that way. And he'd put them in between his licks, and people say, what was that? What was that? You know, the producer would go crazy. What's that? Do that again.
When I started out singing, I used to sing in this little blues bar in New York called Dan Lynch, and they had this amazing jukebox. And I would go over there pretty much every night after I played, and I would play that song, What Becomes of the Broken Heart.
I feel as though that the Broken Heart is a song that could really live again.
Well, no. This will be the audition today and see if we can...
No, it won't be an audition. You've already passed the test. Yeah, I mean, to get an opportunity to see if you really like it after we give me this plan.
All right.
To see if we still have it.
Tell me what
You know, that's one of the, probably one of the more recognizable guitar licks of the early Motown days. And when I originally played it 27 years ago, I didn't think much about it, only that it worked. In the small confines of Studio A, myself and the rest of the musicians didn't realize what an impact we'd have on the rest of the world.
He was very quiet, and he had a mystique about him, but you couldn't find a better, steadier guitarist. And the chords were jazz, but he made it fit in R&B.
They called us the Oreo Cookie Guitar Section because Robert White sat to my right and Eddie Willis sat to my left, and the white boy.
Joseph.
Shortly after Earl Van Dyke died in 1992, I went out to visit Robert in Los Angeles, and we went out to eat. And wouldn't you know it, as we're about to order and the waiter's coming over, all of a sudden you hear the guitar line from My Girl come over the speaker in the restaurant. And Robert got real excited, real animated, and he said, as the waiter walked over, he said, "Hey, man, you hear that? That's... And he stopped dead. And then he kind of looked embarrassed, and he looked down at the menu, and he says, "I think I'll have the barbecue chicken." And then, you know, I just ordered my thing, and the guy walked away, and I said, "Robert, you were going to tell him that was you, weren't you?" He said, he kind of looked embarrassed, he said, yeah, but I don't know. He looked at me, and he said, "Look at this tired old fool." He'd never believe it. And that floored me, because, I mean, here's a guy who played a guitar line that's the equivalent, it's like one of the top five all-time guitar hooks. I mean, it's right up there with Satisfaction by the Stones and Paperback Writer or Come As You Are from Nirvana. At that point, I realized, you know, here's a guy that's lived for 30 years this close to his dream, and yet instead of being inside the dream looking out, he was on the outside of the dream looking in, never able to touch that dream. I knew at that point, you know, Robert desperately needed some recognition in his lifetime. But he didn't make it across the finish line with the rest of the guys. He just didn't make it. When it's cold
outside. The Summer of Love introduced the world to the soaring guitar and pulsating wah-wah of Jimi Hendrix. The following year, Sly Stone's relentless Oakland funk swept over an enraptured public. Mesmerized by these new trends, Motown producer Norman Whitfield enlisted the Funk Brothers, along with innovative newcomers Wawa Watson and Dennis Coffey, to help fuse these new elements into the Motown sound. Psychedelic soul had arrived down in the Snake Pit.
In San Francisco, of course, on the West Coast with Jimi Hendrix, they had a lot of the fuzz tones, and they had the wah-wah pedal and things like that, the special effects on some of the guitars. And what happened was, in one of those earlier sessions where we were rehearsing and working with producers, Norman Whitfield came in, and he brought in this song, Cloud Nine. And I had a wah-wah pedal with me, and I took it out and started playing it, and then within a few days, I got the call to do the session.
Childhood part of my life wasn't very pretty. I was born on the streets of the city. It was a one-room shack with 10 other children beside me. We hardly had enough food, no room to sleep. It was
hard times.
Yeah. I needed something to ease my mind. My father didn't know the meaning of words. He disrespected mother and treated us like dirt. I left the home seeking a job and that did fine. Depressed and downhearted, I took to crime. Now I'm doing on cloud nine.
Watch the streets and back.
or cloud nine.
The show can be what you want to be.
Cloud nine.
You ain't got no responsibility.
Cloud nine.
Anybody play What's Going On like the record ever?
Nobody.
Nowhere.
The only person I ever heard do it was Babbitt. The other last week,
I
heard Babbitt.
Oh, Babbitt did it last
Babbitt.
Week.
Yeah, Babbitt played. When I heard Babbitt, I'm sorry, the other night, it just blew me away, man. It was like, dang, I felt like I was back, you know, 35, 40 years ago as a kid. You know, I'm sorry, what's your say name?
Ralph. You remember, as a bass player in Detroit, I know I came a little later, but after, you know, it was 74, 72. But if you could not play that solo from that record that Bob Babbitt did. You remember Scorpio?
Oh, yeah.
You were the bass player. You couldn't get a gig. You couldn't get a gig. You couldn't play that.
Telling the truth.
You couldn't get a gig.
Oh, man.
You couldn't get a gig. If you couldn't play that around Detroit.
Solo, you ain't doing nothing.
You couldn't.
But see, what was so beautiful about it? People love Babbitt. It wasn't about no color or nothing, man. They just loved his musician. All the cats in the hood, man, that's Babbitt.
When I went to seventh grade, I guess it was, I was in the choir, and the same choir teacher was also the orchestra teacher, and she said to me, well, I know somebody that's going to play bass in the orchestra next year. And boom, it's me. She's looking at and pointing at. So I started playing upright bass. I'm supposed to be studying classical, which I am, as long as my mother and dad are up. As soon as they go to bed, they had some stations on the radio in Pittsburgh where they had what they call race music, where you could hear the black music. And I'd take my bass and go into the kitchen, turn the radio on, and while everybody's sleeping, and I'd be playing with the radio. Around 1967, I had been working live with Stevie Wonder, and Stevie brought me in to do my first session at Motown. Now, you gotta remember, James, he set the bass style for the Motown sound.
Man, nobody could play this.
What?
Yeah, everybody play this land on the back, man.
You could if you were James. James,
this is a story. This is hard to believe.
Oh, man.
But it's really true.
You got to tell me this one.
Let me tell you what happened. Marvin was working on putting all this together with the What's Going On thing. And he was experimenting with a lot of things. But what happened, he decided to need Jameson. So Jameson was working at a local club, and Marvin found out where he was working. He went over there to get him. Jameson was blasted. So he says, well, I got to get him back because I got this. I got to get it off. Brought him back over here to the studio. Jameson really didn't want to do this, but because being Marvin, he said, okay, I'll try it. So Jameson couldn't sit up on his, you know, he had a high stool he used to sit on. He was afraid his own fault.
Right, like a string bass player.
He lay right out where you were laying and started playing this. No one believed it.
I can't
and
believe it.
He did a job that no one could do standing up. He did it laying down. That was James Jameson.
Yeah, the master.
Pressure, nothing. You felt no pressure. It was just like I go in, I haven't played.
Let me say, shorter was pressure. I mean, you're sitting in the Jameson seat.
Right.
And
You know what I'm saying? And as far as that, there was to do what he did was, you know, that you could. I mean, it was almost impossible.
I'm sure you just for yourself.
I just tried to do the best I could. And
another strange question. Now, watching a documentary, it was talking about some of the Atlantic recordings with Aretha Franklin, early recordings, and she had like basically a totally white band from Nashville.
Memphis and Muscle Shoals.
Right. Yeah. Okay. And then Martin Luther King was assassinated. James Brown started to change his vibe with I'm Black, I'm Proud. The whole thing changed. And a lot of people felt, well, we didn't want to use the white musician, we need to keep it to ourselves. Did you feel any sort of coming into this environment that you felt any sort of racial difference?
When I was in there was such a closeness. I mean, I can't. And when Martin King died, they never expressed to me any kind of hostility or anything. And I felt as sad as they did. You know, and but I never did feel anything from any of these guys. I mean, I always felt like. I don't know. I was like one of them. You know?
On the evening of July 23rd, 1967, the Detroit police busted up an after-hours blind pig speakeasy at the corner of 12th and Claremont, and all hell broke loose. The Funk Brothers came out of a recording session to a city in flames.
Yeah, the sky was red. Everything was burning down. You protect your family. That's just the way it was. And I would have gone down for them, even if it was at the hands of a black brother, because he's invading my territory. That's just the way I felt. I didn't think about color. These are my brothers here. So no one had to rally us. It was just, we have to get from here to the car, and that was the only thing we were interested about. It was our mission to get our people home safe.
But I also feel at the same time that had the role been reversed and we had been in an area where it was more predominantly a white area and something broke out, that I would have took a bullet for Jack. I mean,
I believe we'd have done the same. Yeah,
I believe.
The end of the 1960s found America watching in horror as a daily stream of televised death came back from the war in Vietnam. Back on the home front, the cultural and social revolution being waged in the streets was further polarizing the masses. Motown played a preeminent role in the cultural soundtrack that framed all these events, and nowhere more so than in Vietnam, where terrified and disillusioned GIs found comfort in the grooves played by the Funk Brothers and in the words and melodies sung by Motown's stars. But there was no comforting refrain down in the snake pit. Still reeling from the death of Benny Benjamin and concerned that James Jamerson's personal demons were leading him down the same path, the Funk Brothers needed a rallying cry to pull themselves together. In 1970, they found it in What's Going On, Marvin Gaye's anguished plea for sanity in a world gone mad. Helping Marvin realize his vision, the Funk Brothers elevated the level of their artistry from the dance floor to the world stage.
Sister,
brutality,
sister,
talk to me,
sister,
so you
When Marvin Gaye first recorded What's Going On, to us it was a very important record. Musically, we felt that it was some of our best work. It was the first record that Motown ever given the musicians some credit on an album. And little that we know, you know, we were biding our own time. But we kept recording for about another year, and that were many more hits to come, you know. So one day, we went to the studio, and we were supposed to record, and there was a big sign on the door saying, there won't be any work here today. Motown are moving to Los Angeles. Wow, what a break. I suppose they were just looking for a new sound, I suppose, you know. So we just kept doing what we usually do, what we were doing before Motown, and that was playing in the clubs around the city, playing our blues, playing our jazz. That's just about the way it ended.
When Motown left Detroit, there was no warning, no announcement, and no way of preparing for it. And that's the move that they had to make. A major company doesn't have to explain to every individual that they're moving. But it kind of left all of us kind of like, what are we going to do?
Funny thing was, we always had that idea about it would never end. You know, we felt like it would go on and on and on. But as you can see, it ended.
Hoping to hold on to their dreams, some of the Funk Brothers followed Motown out to Los Angeles. But the West Coast music scene was too foreign to them. And without the emotional support the Funk Brothers family had always provided for each other, they were lost.
He misses his friends, the Funk Brothers. Just the atmosphere is totally different in California than in Detroit. He wasn't receiving the phone calls like before, working in the studio. Yeah, to work in the studio. And there was a battle there, you know, of emotions. And probably feeling less than a man, or less than a dad to provide for us from what he used to do before. So I seen a lot of hurt and pain and the illness and the struggles with the alcohol. Wasn't going right for him. He wanted to do everything. He's used to doing everything for everyone. And then it was his time where he needed help. And a lot of times no one was there. Or he didn't want to listen because he can be hard-headed too, so.
In 1983, James Jamerson scalped a ticket for the nationally televised show Motown 25 and slipped into a balcony seat. Sunshine. 2 months later, he slipped away forever.
It's dawning, sunny and bright. But after I've been crying all night, the sun is cold.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's time to give it up. Give up the love for Detroit's unsung musical heroes. The drum section, Uriel Jones and Pistol Allen, and the late Benny Benjamin. On the vibes and percussion, the fabulous Tambourine Man, Jack Asher, and the late Bungo Eddie. Guitar section, the one, none other, the brother, Eddie Willis, Joe Messina, and the late Robert White. On the keyboard, Joe Hunter, Johnny Griffin, and the late, great Earl Van Dyke. And on bass, Bob Babbitt, and the greatest bass player of all time, James Jamerson. Here they are, ladies and gentlemen, the greatest kick machine in music history, the Funk Brothers.
my generation to not only know history, but to also experience it and now to change them. I have so much respect and so much to learn from these people that came before me. I mean, the people are great people, not just great musicians. I think that's what I'll carry with me, is just being able to converse and talk to people who have done so much to influence what I do and what I want to be. The people bring the place alive, and I think that's very important. Hitsville wasn't this building, it was the people that were in the building, and I think that's been made very clear.
Microphones out to the new Chit Chat Lounge located at 8235 12th Street at Virginia Park, where we present again Operation Jazz. right now, and what a crowd we have here. We'll be presenting the James Jamerson Quartet, plus our little jam session and guest stars, guest artists who will be popping in. So come on by. We still have a few more chairs, a few more seats, I should say, and join in on the fun. And now the James Jamerson Quartet gets things underway nicely.